time.
That resurrection morning when all dirt drops out.
Thank you. Thank you. love him. I just thank him. And truly, I would not take anything. Because you know what? This world is not my home. I'm not looking for a girlfriend here. I'm not going to be here forever. My home's over there. And that's a permanent solution, a permanent place that I'm going to. I love you.
Amen.
Well, I started out traveling. But I'm telling you what, it may feel, that justice may feel good for just a second, but if you know God, it's not going to last.
Amen.
If you know the love of God, it will not last. Because I'll tell you what, God will come in and that conviction will come in and he will make you feel miserable. He will make you feel miserable.
Oh, yes.
Because I want you to know, God is not an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth God. There was a time in the Old Testament that's how it played out. Because that's the way it was. There was no grace. There was no mercy. Only very few occasions that they talked about the other night with Enoch, there was grace. We don't understand why.
Right.
I don't know why Enoch was translated. I don't know how come Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord.
Think about it.
I don't know why Abraham was God's friend. That was totally against what was going on at the time. But I want you to know and understand, we are right now in a grace dispensation. We are right now in a dispensation of love and mercy, compassion. Oh, hallelujah. No, God wants you to pour it out there in that world. That's what they're needing today. They're needing to feel that love. They're needing to feel that drawing of the Holy Ghost. They're needing to know that no matter what it looks like out there, in here is refuge.
Amen.
In here is peace. In here is rest.
Yes.
In God, I can do all things through Christ Jesus. I love you.
The strength is me. Hallelujah.
John, it is St. John, but it's our first epistle, General John. Do some reading and try to talk to your head. I knew I wouldn't get to talk to you much, and I didn't feel like I would, so I didn't. I really wanted to hear from the body. And the testimonies have been so good tonight. Nobody wants to go through some of what we've been through, but with children, we wouldn't know anything about God if we didn't. You know, we know what we know because of what we suffered. And we've had to find a way to go on in the face of adversity. All of us. And you may not have been what I've been through, and I may not have been exactly through what you've been through, but we've all got our things that we got to go through.
Amen.
God is God regardless.
That's right.
Of what the situation might be.
You want some water, Brother?
No, honey, water don't help me. I never get dry.
Okay.
I never drink water when I'm preaching. I can sing for 4 hours and not drink water.
That's right.
No,
I'm just the opposite.
Let me suck on this thing here, man. It'll take care of a lot of it. I was thinking about Brother Vic's message Sunday night.
Okay, well, that was good.
For those of you that weren't here,
good.
Tremendous message. There's so much said in just a very short time, but you can see what Vic has learned. He asked me a question one time, and first time I'd seen him after several years, he said, "I remember what you told me one time." And the question he asked me was, "Brother Pat, how do you prove your faith?" I said, "By your faithfulness." He said, "I thought about that for a long time, but I understand what you're talking about now. You prove your faith by your faithfulness." A lot of people say they believe a lot of things, but you can kind of see what they believe by the way they live their life.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
And you're going to prove what you believe because you're going to have to go through things, not to prove it necessarily to anybody else, but to yourself.
Right.
Do you really believe what you believe?
Yes, absolutely.
You're going to have to suffer for it.
Amen.
And what Brother Vic was talking about, and I'm not going to try to preach his message over, because I couldn't add anything to it. But he was talking about how so many people in God are preaching the good life, the good life. And God will give you the good life if you'll be faithful to Him.
Amen.
He knows
Amen.
How to give you the good life.
Amen.
And even then, we go through things. For a long time, we had... The unemployment was the lowest in 50 years in the United States. And, of course, the newspapers all said we got a terrible economy. We're going down the tube. And George Bush has got us in a terrible fix. And I must say, in the last year of his, the last year, and that was after the Democratic took over Congress, now forgive me for that, that's when the gas doubled, $4 a gallon. And that's when things begin to go down the tube. Up to that point, the stock market went as high as almost 15,000. And unemployment was the lowest it had been in 50 years. You could walk across anywhere and get your job. But everybody wanted change. Well, we got change. How do you like the change? What do you think about the change? Never been in such a mess as we're in right now. But guess what? When we get through it, and we will get through it.
Oh, yeah.
God will get us through it.
Amen.
Hopefully, when we get back in some kind of shape, they'll handle it a little bit better than they did last time. But we have a tendency to think, this is going to go on forever. All the good times are going to go on forever. Uh-huh. And sometimes I think God allows things to happen to kind of shake us, shake our tree, make us examine our faith, where we really stand in God.
Yes.
Prove ourselves. Brother Mike Baldock said, for every time we move up another level, we're going to be tried in that level.
That's what
I believe that absolutely.
Yeah.
Every bit of ground God gives you, you're going to be tried on.
Yeah.
And you're going to come to learn and to know exactly what it's all about. But Brother Dick was talking about the good life, and you hear a lot of people, and they measure the good life by how good a job you got, or how much money you got, or how good a car you got. And that's a good life. And in the United States, it's a good life, and God can give you that. If you go out here and all you do is put your hand to making money, you can make money.
Yes.
But somewhere along the line, you're going to forsake the Lord. You're going to forsake service, and you're going to forsake... You understand me now?
Yeah.
And we have a lot of people preaching the prosperity gospel, and I'm going to tell you, I believe God can prosper His people.
Amen.
I believe He not only can, but He will. You put Him first and trust Him. I do believe that.
Amen.
But we don't follow God for that.
No.
I've heard it made fun of when we say, we give not expecting anything in return. A lot of prosperity preachers say that's a dumb thing to say because you ain't going to receive anything unless you expect it. Well, we expect it in this sense. You cannot give God.
Amen. Right. We know that we're going to get
We something. Know that. We couldn't give anything and He ain't going to outgive you.
Right.
If you don't know that, you ought to know it. But when we say we don't expect, what we mean is we don't feel like God owes us anything.
Right.
He don't owe us nothing.
Right.
We give and at the same time saying, God, you don't owe me anything for that. That's what God does.
He's come to thank you.
Amen.
And a lot of people, that's become the good life to them. But Brother Vic was preaching about Sunday night, the abundant life.
Yes. Yes. Absolutely.
Way yonder, deeper than the good life.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
It's walking in His will.
Amen.
It's understanding Him.
Yeah.
It's having peace in the time of trouble.
Amen.
It's having the God knowledge that He's in control.
Yes.
That He's going to take care of everything. It's a person-to-person relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen.
It's knowing you cannot give Him if you give everything you have.
That's right.
It's impossible. You give it one way, He'll give it back to you.
Amen.
How do I know that? I just know it. I know it in my knower. I don't even think about it. So I don't give expecting, but there is an expectation in me knowing that God will take care of me.
He always has.
He's going to supply all my needs according to His riches and glory and a lot of my wants.
Yeah.
Cause men to come and lay things at your feet. I've had people come and give me things that I couldn't even afford to buy and wouldn't take the money out of the budget to go buy it if I could.
Amen.
And God just has to make them just give it to me.
Amen.
I'm telling you what God will do. And that's called the abundant life.
Amen.
To walk in abundance.
Hallelujah.
To walk in the knowledge of the fullness of the Son of God. Mm-hmm. That's when death is present, God is much more present.
Amen.
Right.
Amen. That you take God at His word. You believe Him. You know He's walking with you even when you don't feel Him.
Right.
Even when you don't see it, you don't even see the results of it, you just know it. Because He said, I will never leave you and I'll never forsake you.
Amen.
And when you know it, there's no question about it.
Amen.
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 Every night I say, good night, Jesus.
Amen.
Thanks for walking with me today.
Hallelujah.
Sometimes I don't really feel Him that much, but I know He's there.
He's there.
There's no doubt in my mind about He's there. And when I get up in the morning, I say, good morning, Lord.
Uh-huh.
It's good to serve you, Lord. Walk with me today. Lead me the way that I should go. Send somebody my way that I might be a witness for you. Help me to keep my mouth, Lord. Not say the wrong thing. Don't let me think bad thoughts about people. Let me think about the good things. If there be any virtue and if there be any praise, let me think on these things, Lord. Don't let me listen to any gossip, oh God. That's my prayer. And God pretty well shields me a lot of times. You say, you know this, know this? No, well, that's been going on for a couple months. Well, he just shielded me from it. I didn't know anything about it. And I say, let's just pray about it. What do you say? Let's just give it to the Lord. Don't worry too much about it. Some people are too quick to speak. We ought to be quick to hear and slow to speak.
That's what the Bible says, too.
Amen. We steal our own blessing from God by worrying about other people too much. I'm talking about, you know, and being nosy, I'm talking about. If we're worried about them, take them to the Lord.
Right.
Say, Lord, you take care. And I dare say you can tell when people are going through things. You can sometimes, they can keep above it pretty good, but after a while you begin to say something wrong. Somebody say, oh, I've noticed somebody looking bad. I said, well, they must be going through some trials. Just pray for them. Lift them up. Hold them up. Anybody ever been through any trials?
Amen.
Everybody feel beaten down when you wasn't even worthy to sit in the church?
Yes.
You ever feel like that?
Yes.
Sure you have. Every one of us have.
Yes.
That's the devil's business. Amen. But God's still the same.
Yes.
And he loves us all still the same. Praise the Lord. Yes, that old song says, though it makes him sad to see the way we live, he'll always say, I forgive. And I know, Kenneth, you being close to your mother-in-law, it makes you sad when you see her break down like that. But you know what? Love covers a multitude of sin.
Amen.
You just say a little prayer for her. She has a hard time dealing with things. In lots of ways, she's come a long ways. Amen. And I know she loves God. There's no doubt in my mind. You don't stick around God all those many years without loving God. Right? And so that's how we learn. See, we learn through the things we suffer. And we learn struggling together and trying to work out our salvation. Pretty soon, I don't see anybody's faults but mine. I just see mine, you know. Every time I look in that mirror, I see mine. So I'm too concerned about mine to worry too much about yours. Some people think they have to say something about everything that goes on. There's a time to just be quiet and leave it to God.
Right, amen.
Amen. But you learn this. When you fail and have to repent several times, maybe after a while you come to a point and say, I think I'm going to be a little bit slower to speak.
Amen.
It don't do any good. What good does it do? Think about that. It holds you back when you spend all your time knocking somebody else.
Yes.
What does it do for you? It don't do you any good. Let me read real quickly, and I'm not going to keep you very long. In the first chapter of John, the Epistle of John, that was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled of, the Word of Life. Now, I want to tell you something about John. John called himself in the book of John, the Gospel of John, he called himself that disciple whom Jesus loved.
Yes.
Now, he knew Jesus loved him, didn't he? But he didn't want to brag about it. So he said, that disciple whom Jesus loved. He knew Jesus loved him. But the reason Jesus loved him is John was way ahead of his time. He saw Jesus, Godhead. He saw that he was more than baby Jesus. That he was more than Joseph's son, Mary's son. He knew he was more than that. He recognized his Godhead. He recognized that he was in the midst of something way yonder bigger than he was. And he gave reverence to it. And Jesus felt that and understood and knew John knew who he was, and he loved John for that. That's all part of the abundant life. If you ever come to know Him in His Godhead, if you ever get Him out of that cradle and off of that cross and on His throne, you'll see Him in a lot different way. He said, "For I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last, which is, which was, which is to come, the Almighty." That's what Jesus said. "I, Jesus, have sent mine angel." That's pretty powerful. Amen. I believe they said they searched heaven trying to find one worthy. And there was none worthy but the Lamb. The Lamb alone was worthy.
Yes.
He was worthy. And the Father gave all power to Him. That means outside of Him, there is no power.
Right.
He's got all the power.
Yes.
If there's another God, He wouldn't have any power.
Right.
Because Jesus said, "All power in heaven and earth is given unto me." Now, if you ever see Jesus in that context, you begin to realize His power and His authority.
Amen.
John understood that.
Yes,
John knew that. He knew he was walking with God. I'm sure he didn't fully understand it, because here's a man, worked in a carpenter shop, probably had bruises and probably had splinters in his finger and sweating, went through all the things that men do, but there was something else there present. Even there was a spiritual being of God, a part of God, was standing there in front of him. The express image of the invisible God, I believe is what it said. The express image of his person. He was the person of God. Think about that. And John understood this. That's why when you read this, you read any of John's writings, and he's way yonder deeper than the rest of them.
Oh, yes.
He said, "We looked upon our hands and handled of the word of life." Now, when he's talking about coming in that abundant life, he's talking about coming into a place where you actually handle God. You know God. He's not a figment of your imagination. He's not way out there in the universe somewhere. He's right here.
Amen.
He's in you, the Bible said, except you be reprobate. If you've been born of God, then he's in you. Christ in you, your hope of glory. Think about that. Amen. I said, "For the life was manifested, and we have seen it and bear witness and show in you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested unto us. That which we have seen and heard declare we unto you." Now, what the reason he gave this is so we can declare it. Brother Vic declared it here Sunday night in a very simplistic manner, but he made it plain as a nose upon your face. I'm so thankful that he found that place.
Yes.
He went through some things to get the knowledge, to understand what he's talking about. He's not just blowing hot air. He was talking about something he knew something about. And he told us about that abundant life. It's available to every believer. Some people blow a lifetime and don't understand it all. They don't even understand what you're talking about. There's a measure in God that we need to get to where God will reveal himself to us. He said that we may have, that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And these things write we unto you that your joy may be full. You know what comes along with this? Joy, joy, joy. The joy of the Lord is our strength.
Amen.
If you don't have a lot of joy, it makes me know you really don't know him like you should. I see people that are like an old horse eating cactus out of a churn. They're just not happy people. They don't... That's a long face.
That's a long face.
You see a lot of long-faced Christians. I worked with a guy one time at a brickyard, and he told me, now he didn't serve God, but he had a brother that did, and he said, "That's the saddest man I ever knew. That's the most unhappy man I ever knew. He's been a Christian all his life." And he said, "It really gets me, these down in the mouth Christians." If they really got what they claimed they got, see to me, they'd be happy.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Think so.
Happy.
Now, I tell you, I ain't got much, but I'm happy.
Amen.
Happy.
Things are not always comfortable for me, but I'm happy.
Amen.
I go around singing the song all the time. Ain't got time to be unhappy. Ain't got time to be unhappy. Sister Carol used to get the biggest kick out of me singing the song. Loving you makes me want to slap my pappy, and I ain't got time to be unhappy. I used to sing it to Carol. She just laughed. She'd hear crazy in that book. But I ain't got time to be unhappy. Don't come around me with a bunch of sad stuff. I ain't got time. I'm on the way to heaven. I don't want to hear it.
Amen.
Tell me something good about God. What's God doing? That's what I want to hear.
Amen.
And you'd be surprised how many people get caught in that level. And it'll destroy you. It'll tear you down. It'll take your faith. It'll cause you, regardless of how good you got it, sit around and talk about how bad you got it. You know, when I went to work at Ford Motor Company, I worked at the brickyard. And I was making $1.45 an hour. And I hired in at Ford, $3.90 an hour, 15 cents cost of living, and went on the afternoon shift, so I got a 10% night bonus. I made heaven. I didn't know they paid people with money like this. And went to work in there, and I worked right alongside guys. A lot of them with bright pink shirts on or yellow shirts on. They never got nothing dirty but their hands. They come in there clean as a whistle in the morning and clean as a whistle at the end of the day. And I wonder, how in the world? I tell you, I don't care where you put me. You give me a pink shirt, it's going to be dirty when I get home. I finally had to start wearing coveralls. But these guys would sit around and they'd whine and cry and moan and groan and... I said, boys, you ought to go load 10,000 brick a day. You find out what work is.
Yeah,
man, right. I mean, a guy took me to the table. I had to prepare parts to go for the assembly line. And he said, sit down here. And he said, here's what you got to do. And you got to make up these. And then they'll take them to line. And the guys will assemble them, take them to the assembly line. And then I said, you mean this is all I got to do? He said, this is it. I said, I have paid ever. I didn't know they paid people that kind of money to do that kind of stuff. And these guys crying and whining and moaning and groaning. They just and just caused such an awful, awful atmosphere to work in. One time we went on strike, went on a wildcat strike, and I told this years ago here in this church. We walked out, and I was working 7 days a week. Never knew they paid such money. Easy as pie, instead of going to work the weekend, well, I might as well. I mean, I'm just sitting at the table not doing much. Getting double time for Sunday, time and a half for Saturday.
Yeah.
And most of them work Saturday and Sunday and lay off Monday. They did a lot of that. And you'd think those poor people, how they've done that. You see now, they managed to get the car companies moved out of the country now to this. Destroyed the car business, you know.
Yeah.
Now they wish they had that back. They used to make fun of me because I worked. And she tried to make us all look bad. I said, boys, I'm just trying to make my pay. I'm getting paid. If I didn't want to work, I'd go home. Stay home. If you don't want to work, go home.
Amen.
I don't understand it. I sure ain't killing myself. I never had a seizure in my life. And you had to deal with that kind of stuff. And that's what some of that stuff is what's happened to our country. That's why they went down the tube in lots of ways. That's why all the businesses left the country. They're never happy. Nobody's ever happy. Praise the Lord. And so we can find ourselves in this. But through all of this, John recognized Jesus and who he was. So he's writing these things. Amen. He said, and these things write we unto you that your joy may be full. This then is the message which we have heard of him and declare unto you that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth.
Amen.
But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. Folks, we've been here 22 years this month, last month, a third of last month, 22 years. We've had our struggles. We've had our problems. We've had some come, some go, and some go, come, and go, and come, and go, and come, and go. And when they come back, we treat them like they never left. We love everybody. That's what it is. But you watch some churches, they never can really find their place. And the reason is they haven't really found what I'm talking to you about. The abundant life. There's something more than just filling a seat. There's something more than going to church because you have to. Or because somebody expects you to. Or somebody will talk about you if you don't. Or just for some system, some reason, trying to impress somebody. There's an abundant life here. There's something way beyond what you see. It's a spiritual thing. It's a thing you can get a hold of. But it's spiritual. You got to kind of sell out for it. You have to say, I'm not going to be satisfied with just this little bit. I want something a little bit more. There's something more for you here. For some of you than you've ever seen yet. And I dare say for every one of us, there's a little bit more here. But once we see it and we begin to walk after it, we're not happy with anything else. See, that's like being an entertainer. There's time in my life I was an entertainer. And there's some people trying to use me as an entertainer. Oh, you got entertainment, people will come around. You know. That's the reason if I got really hungry, I'd take my guitar, put it on the square, and open the case. Same on the street. On the street.
Yes.
I shouldn't have people throwing money in there. I guarantee.
True.
I can sing 4 hours and they're singing the same song.
That's true.
Yes,
I know what I can do.
Yeah,
I can. Of course, that ain't what God called me to do. But I mean, I have the knowledge. I have to understand I can do that. Sister Daisy's been with me places. She knows if the president calls and I want you to come and sing,
do it.
I'd take my guitar, go up, and I'd put it on the show. It ain't no big deal. Been doing it for years.
Yep.
But see, I've moved beyond being an entertainer. I don't have to sing all the time. Maybe that's, they said one time when I was going to Sister Betty, she said, if he didn't sing every night, he'd soon backslide. So I got down with this situation like what I got right now, and I went about 6 or 8 weeks and didn't sing a song. I didn't backslide. Maybe it just proves somebody they didn't know what they're talking about.
Yeah.
I don't know what this is all about. I ain't worried about it, but I feel pretty good, actually.
Amen.
It's just my time. But guess what? It don't matter if I don't sing. We got a lot of singers around here. And that's fine with me. You understand me? I get frustrated because I want to die. I want to do something, you know. But let me tell you something. It's all right with me if somebody else does it. I don't care. See? Because I've moved beyond that now. I'm wanting to hear from God.
Amen. That's right.
I don't care if He speaks through this or that or this or that. I don't care. I want to hear from God.
Amen.
That's what it's all about.
That's what it's all about. I love watching these young pickers improving, and they're coming along. And watch these girls get up and they get into it. I mean, that Kimmy, buddy, she get down, buddy. I enjoy watching that. There's something special about that. Amen. I get excited. She gets excited. I get excited. I want to get up with her. I can wave my hand for her. You know? When she's waving in the hands, I want to get up behind her and wave mine. I enjoy people again, and I guarantee you some people say, what's the worst you doing that for? Well, close your eyes, you have to get your mind on the Lord.
All right.
Worship the Lord, worship God.
That's right.
Amen. That's her way of expressing herself, and it's fine with me. I don't care.
Absolutely.
I'll tell you something, children. Amen. I love to see people grow in grace and knowledge of the Lord, and I know that God's got available for all of us. He wants us all to grow. He wants us all to improve. I don't care what kind of a gift from God, you can make it better. You can hone it. You can work with it. You can make it better. I don't care what your gift is, you can make it better.
Yeah,
if you work at it.
That's right.
And nobody can do it like you can. That's why God called you especially. He wants you to do it your way. Oh, I wish I could do it like Brother Pat. No, he wants to do it like you do. He wants you to do it your way.
Amen.
That's right.
See, every one of us is special. Every one of us has got our own place. Now, you know that's true, don't you? There are some people in here that they don't have to do very much anything, and they just bless me today. Because everybody's got their way. And God wants to use you just like you are. You don't have to be like me to be used. You just do it your way, and God will make a way, won't He?
Amen.
Amen. That's what that abundant life is all about. I want fellowship. I want to have fellowship. I want us to be able to fellowship one another. And I'm not talking about ship the fella. I'm talking about fellowship. There are those that ship the fella, they call it fellowship. Years ago, we used to have fellowship meetings. And people would use the fellowship meeting to try to get to somebody.
Oh, yes.
They really weren't fellowship.
Oh, it was horrible.
The shows.
Yes, they were.
And they get up. And Sister Wilson used to come here. She was 93 when I did her funeral. But she used to come here, and she's the sweetest old lady. She said that she was out working in the garden, and she had a pair of culottes on.
Yeah.
Oh, my.
Yeah.
And she tried to do that because she knew she didn't want to look too bad bending over in her garden and all that. And one of the old saints come by and seen her out there in them culottes. And she said, I wouldn't thought too much about it, but the next service night, this lady got up and gave a big red hot testimony. Said, I tell you one thing, said, I wouldn't dress like the world. I wouldn't care if it was a pair of culottes or what it was. And of course she knew. You know who she talked to, don't you? Well, Sister Wilson did too. But that's her way of getting to sister. Now, she thought she's testifying for the Lord. She's just wasting breath.
Yep. Hurting herself.
Yeah. We went through a thing here a couple years ago. And I preached about praise. What praise was. We're talking about a praise service. Mm-hmm. Not necessarily a testimony service. Now, we had some testimonies tonight, but most times on Tuesday night, we have some testimony service. Because we talk about healing, we talk about different things that people have been through and what God's done and so forth, and we have testimonies. But sometimes we call for a praise service. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of people don't even know how to get up and say, I praise God, He's been so good to me. I mean, He's been with me, I don't care how hard it gets. I turn to God and He's always there, and He makes a way for me, and He blesses my home, and He blesses my family, and He's good to my children, He's good to my dog, He's good to my birds. You know what I mean?
Yes.
Got good things to say about God. Now that's a praise.
Amen.
And some people get up and they praise, you're going to give a praise.
Dog died.
Yeah, my bird died, and my dog got sick, and they go on back when I was in the army back there about 40 years ago, and I remember very well, and they go on and on and on and on, and I've watched it, and anyway, I told a listener about that, and I said, now the next time we get together, we're going to have praise, and we're not going to have testimony, we're going to have praise, and I think everybody in here ought to have a praise for God. Now, you know, if I say that, you know good well, if you're a child of God and you've been blessed, you ought to have a praise.
That's right, amen.
And if you ain't got a praise, you ought to practice it.
That's right.
Go ahead and stand behind the house and say, Lord, I just praise you. Lord, I just praise you. God, you're just so good. And do that until you know how to praise Him.
Amen.
Some people so worried about wanting to say the right words. It's not in the words. It's in the praise.
No.
It's in the praise. It's in the heart.
Yeah.
It touches God's heart.
Yes.
It blesses God when you praise Him.
Amen.
Oh, God, you've been so good to me, Brother Remy City. Give me that nice home. And I know he's happy about that home. God gave me that home. Made a way for me. This is something they really, really needed.
Yes.
When you live in a little bitty old place, you got much room. And of course, you accumulate stuff over a period of time. Before you know it, every way you turn, you're bumping into something. And buddy, they got room to spread out. Now, he'd sit Bobby in one part of the house, he'd go to the other part of the house. And it's still got room. And it's nice. It's nice. I don't care what anybody says. It's something to praise God for.
Yes.
Plenty of room to eat.
Yeah, amen.
He was so nice to fix us dinner Sunday,
yeah,
too, buddy. It was good.
Nice.
It was great.
Yeah. Very nice.
And I appreciate it. But see, there's an abundant life, and that's what the abundant life is all about. You know, if we went about every day and said, Lord, when I get to church tonight, give me a word.
Yes.
Let me say something about you tonight. Mm-hmm. Something will lift you up, Lord. Mm-hmm. Something will touch somebody's life.
Amen.
Let me praise you. I guarantee you, he'll give it to you.
Yeah. Yeah.
You come in more. Oh, you ever say, oh, I wish I could testify like that. And over there, open your mouth. He said, now feel it.
Amen.
You can't sit back in your seat and say, get up. You know what? Get up. Now get up in Jesus' name. Get up. And you can't tell me that you got the same spirit of God I got. There's several on the line. That spirit don't say, get up. Say something.
Yeah.
He wants you to say something.
Yes, amen.
If you're saved and you know it, say amen.
Amen.
One of the greatest times we had was on that float and was going through that, and it was all singing, tell the world that Jesus saves. Tell the world that Jesus saves. Tell the wondrous story of his grace and glory. Tell the world that Jesus saves. Something beautiful about that. Something wonderful about that. Hallelujah. That's what God wants us to have.
Amen.
Amen. So it said, if we say we have no sin, I'm going to read here. If we walk in the light, as he is in the light, and I read that, we have fellowship on one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. I want you to understand something. That is our initial Adamic sin. He covers that. He forgives that initial Adamic sin.
Amen.
He forgives our present sin.
Yes.
And he forgives our future sin.
Yes.
All we have to do is confess it, and he'll forgive it.
Yes, he will.
And every day that we live, we say, Lord, if I have wounded any soul today,
amen.
If I have caused one foot to go astray, if I have walked in my own willful way, Lord, forgive.
Yes.
And the Bible said we have this confidence,
yes,
that we ask him,
amen,
he will heal our sin.
Amen.
If we have this confidence, when we ask, we know we're going to receive the petition that we ask for. That's one of my very favorite scriptures. We have this confidence. Not because trembles go down our leg. Not because we really feel like we're victorious. But just simply because the Word says it. We have this confidence. Amen. That if we ask, he is faithful.
Yes.
To forgive our sin.
Yes.
Amen. Leave that mic alone.
You can ever see that and understand that. And not only your past sin,
yes,
but your present sin,
amen,
and your future sin.
Amen.
See, that's nothing to quit over, Tony. It's all covered.
Amen.
And we have to accept that and believe that. And maybe times we just have to say, Lord, help me get through this. Lord, this is hard for me.
Yes.
But help me get through it.
Yeah.
And guess what? The sun will come up in the morning.
Amen.
It'll shine again.
Yeah.
The unction will come into your heart. Just preach once again. He don't give a gift to preaching and then take it away from
you. Nope. Right.
Now he gives that gift and it's forever. It's without repentance. God never repents of a gift that he gives you.
No,
it'll grow. He can make it grow. I know my time is all gone. I didn't mean to keep you this long. But it said if we confess our sin, he's faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar and his word is not in us.
Amen.
Children, it's coming to know him. in a better way. More than just a good life. Of course, we want a good life. If we work, we can make a better life for ourselves. If we work at it, struggle with it, we can make a better life. For God will give us a better life. And that good life is a good life. But what we really need is the abundant life.
Amen.
I mean, he's gonna save us in spite of ourselves. He's going to save us when we're so mean and when we don't even deserve to be saved. But if we'll keep coming and hang in and believe Him,
Amen.
Trust His Word and read His Word and pray and seek Him out, don't let nothing knock you out of this.
No.
Tony said, I decided I wouldn't go preach no more. Everybody's had that thought along the way. But you can't do that because it's not your gospel.
That's
no.
right.
It's not your gospel. It's His gospel.
Mm-hmm.
And He called you to preach it.
Yes.
So if you got to preach it, what are you going to do? In one way or another, you got to preach it. It may not be the way I do it. It may not be even in a pulpit ministry. But whatever way He's got for you to preach it, you got to preach it.
Yes.
Amen. I'm thankful for what I know about God today. Hey, I'm feeling pretty good right now.
Yeah.
I'm stronger, I think, right now than I was from the start. Ain't God good?
Yes, He is.
And I'm trusting Him. I'm believing He's going to take care of everything.
Yes, He will.
Amen. God is good. God bless you. Let Ronnie dismiss us tonight.
Oh.